What about you, Camilla? How do you fit into this? When you go to a supermarket, do you turn all the packaging around and read the list of ingredients? Or after a long day at work studying these things, you prefer not to?
Of course I do. I think I nearly managed to get a whole list of e-numbers by heart. And yes, I still can't resist reading the label on the back of a package.
Hello and welcome to another episode of Science on the Menu. My name is Ed Bray and I work in the communications team at the European Food Safety Authority, EFSA. Joining me today is Camilla Smeraldi. You are the team leader for the team at EFSA dealing with food additives and flavorings. Welcome to the podcast, Camilla.
Thank you.
Today, we're going to be talking exactly about this. So food additives. What is in our food? What are those e-numbers that we see on the back of the packaging? So, Camilla, we're really glad to have you help us unravel this. And actually, to look at this more closely, we've got some foods here today to look at. So I'm going to bring them out for you, and we're going to have a look and see what's in there and what are the different food additives. So to start, we're going to start with these. So you can hear, those listening, you can hear what's in here, but you won't know. I've got a vegan protein bar here that I picked up from the supermarket. Now, interestingly, it's got three different additives in there. So it's got soy lecithin, it's got sorbitol, and it's got potassium sorbate. Can you talk us through what are those three additives doing in there?
As every food additive that's added to the food, they are there because they have to have a technological function. And the three that you mentioned have three different technological functions, in fact, starting from the potassium sorbate, which is an antioxidant, so it's there to preserve the food, to keep it stable over the time. Mm-hmm. Moving on, you mentioned the soy lecithin. That's an emulsifier, and as all emulsifiers, they help whenever we have two different phases, water and oil. And so again, it helps in keeping the two phases together and keeping the food together. And the last you mentioned, sorbitol, that can have more than one function. So it is listed in the EU as a sweetener, but it has also some baking properties.
Okay. The emulsifier is interesting. So it's a natural element of the food that the oil and fat will separate. Tell us more about that. If mayonnaise, for example, is a classic. How does that work? Why do you need an emulsifier sometimes?
Yeah, I think we probably made mayonnaise at home, haven't you tried? And there's always that thriller. Will it stay nicely firm,
right,
or will it be a disaster and the two phases will separate? So what emulsifiers do is really helping out the two different immiscible phases to stay together, to stay put, to stay firm, and delay a process which naturally occur of the two parts slowly separating and ending up with, the separation of the two and the food, which usually it's really not nice for the texture, what you would expect out of a nice mayonnaise. So at home, we don't put it when we prepare mayonnaise. We usually try to do our best and crossing our fingers that everything will stay together. But it's also true that when we prepare mayonnaise at home, then usually it's eaten within hours, the day. We keep it in the fridge and then it's gone.
Right.
So when you think about emulsifier on a larger scale, on an industrial production, of course, the food that is prepared, a mayonnaise which is sold in a jar or in a tube, has to stay on a shelf, it has to stay there for months. So that's where all these food additives exert their technological function. That's why they're there, to keep our food for longer and keep it safe.
Right, we can come on to that. The food system that we have today, where we go to the supermarket and these products are on the shelves, etc. Let's move on to which other additives we've got here. So these are particularly colourful. I've got here some flowers that are edible that can go on cakes. So in here, I looked at the label and there were a series of E numbers. So E100 and different ones. I think there were 7 or 8 in there. What are these additives doing in there?
Whenever you see an E number, that's the system that it's in place to tell you that there is a food additive added. And in particular, when you see an E number beginning in the 100 series, that means that it's a food color. Food colors, of course, it goes without saying, they are there to give a color to the food. They cannot be added to every food because one of the basic pillars of the EU legislation on food additives is that the use of food additives should not mislead consumers. So, for instance, there are certain types of food where food colors are not allowed to be added,
right?
Because they could be used maybe to hide some adulterations or some fraudulent practices.
Like, for example,
there are maybe some food colors can be added to butter, to oil, for instance, hide maybe the fact that these have been there for a while.
Right. And that's not allowed.
That's not allowed by the legislation. In the case that you are presenting there, the decoration flowers, of course, instead they're using permitted food additives in that food category.
Right.
There can be different food colors. In the range of the E100, you can find those that are the so-called synthetic food colors, but there are also many of them that come out of, say, natural extract that can be extracted from plants, edible materials. Some are very common, like, I don't know, could come from carrot or lycopene from tomatoes. And other sources of botanical origin.
Right.
Some other may come from algae, for instance. Of course, it means that the food additive has been processed. So the main difference is that when we talk about a synthetic food color, it's usually one substance, whereas whenever we are talking about an extract that comes out of a plant, we are there in the presence of a mixture of different components that all contribute to the final color.
Right, right. Let's move on. Let's get these last three out. So we've got here, these are some sweets. So some classic sweets that you would find in a supermarket, different colors there. We've got different food product here. So this is some Italian salami. We'll put that there. And then finally, we've got some ginger here. So this is ginger that is dry ginger, table ginger. Now this has sulfate in it. Here we've got in the ham, we've got, so the salami, we've got sodium nitrite, potassium nitrate. And in the sweets, we've got citric acid. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us, talk us through there, what's going on?
Well, the nitrates are, of course, the food additives that are added to help preserving the meat.
Right.
EFSA had reviewed the safety of nitrates some years ago, and based on that opinion, recently there have been a revision also of the limits of the quantity of the food additive that can go into specific food categories where these food additives can be used. You have always to remember that for every food additive, the legislation specifies in which food categories it can be used, how much it can be used. And the work of EFSA is exactly to help the risk managers taking these decisions. How we do that, we try to establish for every substance which is used an amount that we confidently trust that it doesn't affect the safety of the consumers.
Mm-hmm.
And then we estimate an exposure, a theoretical exposure, We run several scenarios for this theoretical exposure. So one is, imagine that these food additives are authorized at certain levels and somebody has really the habit of eating always the same food every day of their life and always the food which has the highest concentration of that food additive. So it's, right, it's a conservative, say, scenario.
Very loyal to the brand, as it's called.
Very loyal to the brand, exactly. That's how it's called, in fact, brand loyal. So we try to set a value which we consider and we are confident that it's safe. And then we compare it with the value of exposure for a typical consumer. And that should inform the risk manager, for instance.
The European Commission, essentially.
Yes. Yeah. European Commission and the member states, and has it happened, for instance, in the case of nitrates, that value, the risk managers can work on the permitted uses, maybe limiting somewhere, revisiting where these food additives are really needed, or which level are they really needed, or are they sufficient to exert the technological function that they should exert. Yeah. And then revise the limits.
That's right.
Another element to be taken into account, as we mentioned, nitrates, for instance, there's not only the added quantity or that we can ingest when we eat a food that contains a food additive, but many of these substances are anyway naturally occurring. So, of course, the risk managers need also to take into account the fact that there will be anyway a background exposure from the diet.
Right, so we're getting nitrates from like leafy vegetables like spinach, etc. But here they're used as an additive, so they're an extra. And I guess that's the important question, is are they needed? Like, are they really needed? You don't look at that.
No, that's not in the remit of EFSA. In fact, what we look at is really, are they safe?
Right, okay.
Are they needed? Of course, again, it's another of the pillar in the EU legislation. So for a food additive to be authorized, there has to be a technological function. And the one that probably we all experience also in our daily life in the kitchen, no? You squeeze a bit of lemon if
right.
you don't want a fruit or a vegetable to become darker, and that you are
right.
basically adding an antioxidant, or yes, maybe in the past, in the very past, there's something that really goes back in the history of mankind.
Right, I guess that's the big question. So we've always, as humans, been trying to preserve food. It goes off over time, and we've been using salt or vinegar. We've been finding ways to keep the food for longer. I guess the big change happened after the Second World War, I imagine in the 1950s, is that right? When we started to go to big supermarkets and to change our lifestyles as consumers, you know, we started to have ready-made meals and these kind of things. How did that change how we eat?
Yeah, as you said, I think I'm not an historian. I can only figure it out from what I learned or heard, that of course our relationship with food changed significantly. And as you say, especially in many parts of Europe, you mentioned Second World War, so there were months or years of food that being deprived of foods, and then few years later, a new, say, economic status, availability of different staples that were not there, the opening of supermarket, change in the socioeconomic life of many of us in Europe, but even other parts of the world, have definitely created a push for the production of food on a large scale, availability of foods on that had to fill in the shelves of supermarkets, and then it goes on with maybe less time available to cook, to prepare everything from scratch. And also, so maybe a growing demand, I think, yeah.
Right.
Really,
and additives are a byproduct of that.
Somehow we have expectations about reproducibility of food. Whenever you cook at home, it's hardly that you get the same results twice, no? So,
right.
But of course, when you buy something, and again, you are expecting something out of that. So there's clearly an element of reproducibility. And also, as you mentioned, large scale implies the need for avoiding food waste.
Right.
Food has to stay on the shelf for longer. Can it's unthinkable that the food spoils quickly. So that clearly probably gave a push to
right.
to the use and as I say, change of habits. In the families that and probably less time from cooking everything from scratch.
Right. And what about you, Camilla? How do you fit into this? When you go to a supermarket, do you turn all the packaging around and read the list of ingredients? Or after a long day at work studying these things, you prefer not to?
Of course I do. I think I nearly managed to get a whole list of e-numbers by heart getting there. And yes, I still can't resist reading the label on the back of a package. So I see somebody has now this app that you can scan
right.
and get the ingredient list. Probably
right.
more friendly for the vision than sometimes the small prints on the label. But I still do. I still check. Also because, I mean, as I said at the beginning, food is not only made of additives. So there are also other ingredients that I want to be conscious of when I do the choices.
Sure. What would be your advice to someone like me? I've got a range of products in front of me. I don't necessarily maybe know all the terms of what I see on the packet, but I want to eat healthily. I don't want to have food with, you know, additives that don't need to be there. What's your advice to me?
My general advice to everybody would be really the change of diet.
Right.
Really, I'm always nagging my daughter because every morning she got cereals for breakfast. There's no way of changing this habit.
Right.
So what I do, I just change the brand just because I don't want to live with a brand loyal scenario at home. And so my advice for everybody would be really to try and have the most varied diets that you can have. So that, say, when we study, we rely quite a lot on studies conducted on animals. And of course, I mean, mainly rodents. The diet of these poor animals is really the same day
right.
after day after day. And then if you think about when we are really brand loyal to something.
Right.
We are really very, very close to that.
Right.
So day after day after day, you will get the same package out of the same foods. And so that for me, you're really getting close to the scenario that we're using for estimating exposure. So my advice would be try to change your diet. And also maybe try to dedicate some time, you know? So if you can have an apple and maybe rather than a dried apple, but
right,
that's
right.
in general.
So a healthy diet, but also very varied. So I should check out maybe some areas of the supermarket where maybe I go less often and get some things from there as well.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, let's leave it there. Thanks very much for joining us, Camilla. I learned a lot. And thanks very much to our listeners and viewers for joining us on another episode of Science on the Menu. Please subscribe to our podcast if you didn't already. Share it, like it, rate it. You can see the previous episodes on our website. But for now, that's all from me. Thank you again, Camilla.
Thank you.
And see you next time on Science on the Menu. Goodbye.
Bye-bye.